Hey everyone, welcome to Spotlight with Suman. We are back once again with another exciting episode. Every week we come and present to you one image consultant from ICBI, and we make sure that we give some sort of a value addition. Also ask some exciting questions which are also very informative for everybody. So this time the guest for the day would be Diya Khurana, Diya Rajpal Khurana. She's a certified image consultant from Image Consulting Business Institute, style etiquette and wardrobe specialist, corporate personal stylist and uniform designer. She's a very talented individual. She's from Vadodara. So right now I'll be going live with her directly from Vadodara. So waiting for Diya's request. I hope this live session also brings a lot of value add to all of you, because that's the whole idea, to share a lot of insights on the kind of work all these image consultants are doing. Diya, you need to send in a request. Hi Diya.
Good afternoon, ma'am. How are you?
Very well. How are you doing?
I'm good. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Well in time.
Yes, ma'am. I actually sent the request and I was a little worried because I'm in Indore right now. We're at my mom's place.
Oh, yeah.
And the connectivity here was a little, so I was just worried whether, you know, this is always an issue when there are live sessions.
Yeah. Absolutely. So how are things with you and how is the lockdown situation in Indore?
Actually, I came down to see my parents. It's a 4.5-hour drive, ma'am. So we just came home to home and we'll be back. It was a good break for the kids. Uh-huh. As far as the lockdown is concerned, I know it's a pandemic that's affected a lot of people very badly. But to be honest, professionally, in the past 4 months, work-wise, fingers crossed, have been very good. In fact, if I honestly tell you, the amount of work that I have done in these past 4 months is more than the amount of work that I have done in the past 8-9 months or the entire year put together.
I know you're on your toes and you're keeping yourself absolutely busy. So yes, in continuation to that question, I want to ask you that, I mean, being a homemaker, being a mother, a wife and a daughter-in-law, I mean, how does your everyday look like? I mean, what do you do? I mean, the entire day, what does it look like? Must be crazy, I'm sure.
Yes, ma'am, because the kids are having their online school. So their school starts at 8:45. So I wake up early. I think that's the key. And that's been one thing that has helped me throughout since the day I've started working, is that I wake up early. And that is the, you know, the time when there's nobody in the house. So I organize my work, the things that I need to do for the kids before 7:30, because from 7:45, once their school starts, it just gets crazy. And 1:00, they finish. And from 2 p.m. to 7:30, 8 p.m., my work starts. But fortunately, my husband comes back a little early these days. So he's back by 5:36 and he takes over.
He does go to work, right?
He is going to work, yes, ma'am. Past 1 month, he started. So this last 1 month he's been going. Till then he was home. So till he was home, I wasn't worried at all. He was taking care of the kids. He was taking care of everything. But once he started work, and even their school started at the same time. So till 1:00, I'm on duty. 2 p.m., my family kind of takes over. And then from 2 to 6:30, 7, 8:00 normally is the working hours. As in whether it's a session with a client or whether it's a training or anything. But that's my work time. 2 to 8. I mean, it's just changed. You know, earlier it used to be the morning time used to be our work time till the kids came back home till 4. And now it's exactly the opposite.
True. So tell me something. I mean, you are in a joint family. And probably this is the right time to ask you this question because you're not in Vadodara and you are in Indore. What kind of professional challenges do you encounter being in a joint family?
Ma'am, initially, because the family is used to you being around.
True.
And the entire family is used to one person being there for everything. So initially, when you start working, it is a little challenging, not only for the family to adjust to the fact that now you're not there. And even for me as a person, you know, that guilt that you kind of deal with, that this is the time that, you know, these are things that I'm supposed to do.
Right.
But time kind of helps settle everything. So now they are very used to it. It's been 10 years, ma'am. I completed 10 years working as an image consultant. And now they are kind of used to it. The whole family, including my kids, my 7-year-old, he was born while I was doing the program. So he has actually grown up in these past 7 years looking at me work. So he has adjusted around the fact that I have my own things to do. I have my own work to do. And everything has settled around it. But that initial stage, you have to stick strongly. I mean, you have to be very firm about the fact that this is something that you have to do for yourself. And then kind of things just settle. Everybody slowly and gradually accepts it. And then things just kind of, it's like in a flow.
So, Diya, it's been 10 years, huh?
Yes, ma'am. It's been, now that I think of it, I have a clear memory of seeing you when we came for the first time for the image session. I have those memories in my head. I have memories of doing my assignments. I have memories of being, you know, staying up late to submit assignments on time. Because Manya was, my firstborn was very small, very young at that time. I have memories of the stress of the written tests that we used to give. And now I feel suddenly it's been 10 years. I mean, 10 years of being certified, 10 years of going through, you know, so much of up and down, the insecurities that when we were just recently certified, I used to think that, you know, I'm somebody, why will anybody ever come to me for fashion advice? I mean,
in fact,
that's where I come from.
That, you know, I mean, when you people started in Vadodara, that was also one of the biggest apprehension that Vadodara mein kaun image consulting karega, kisi ko pata bhi nahi chalega ki Vadodara mein image consultants hain. So, I mean, how has that mindset changed? I mean, basically over a period of time in last 10 years, do people know what image consultants are? And I mean, do they come to you for work or how is it?
So, ma'am, the first 2 years was when we used to go out to somebody and introduce ourselves and they used to say, oh, what does an image consultant do? But post that, I think it's, of course, it's got a lot to do with the marketing for the profession that has happened. But now everybody knows. In fact, past 2-3 years, people have searched for image consultants on Google, Image Consultants Baroda. That's what they tell us. And they've looked through profiles, they've gone through profiles, seen their body of work, and then contacted us. So yes, that mindset was also there. Apart from the insecurity of the fact that, you know, I come from a space where I thought that somebody would never come to me for the fact that, you know, what do I wear? Because if you ask my family, my background was I myself never was bothered with what I wore. So that was one part of it. And the second was that we are from a 2-tier town or maybe a 3-tier town. Baroda is so small. But trust me, today I feel that we've not even tapped 10% of the Baroda market. There is so much more because of the amount of awareness that has been created. And now that suddenly the focus on self, you know, if you see self-love, self-development, skill development, suddenly this entire focus on self has also brought image consulting to the fore. And it's, I feel there is endless potential.
So somebody is asking this question, what is image consulting? So if you could just give the answer.
Okay. So honestly, if you ask me, image consulting is a profession that helps us. This is very simply what I very strongly feel about it, that it helps us or empowers us to communicate what we are from within, visually from outside. It's actually a non-verbal language that nobody really spoke about. So visual appearance comes.
I think there was a loss in connection. So I think Dia is going to join in soon. Waiting for Dia to send in a request again. Dia, are you there?
Sorry,
Yes,
ma'am.
Dia, I think we lost you in between.
Yes, ma'am. Connectivity here is an issue. I apologize.
Okay, so let's start with what is image consulting?
Yes, so what I was talking about is it's the art and science of presenting yourself in a manner that you're able to visually communicate what you want to communicate. You're able to control what another person or in an individual thinks about you. And people often ask me that, why is my image so important? Why another individual, what he or she thinks about me is so important? And I always tell them that it is important because the way they treat you depends upon what they think of you or what image they have about you. So if you want to be treated with respect, your image needs to be of somebody who is worthy of that respect. And we ourselves are responsible for creating that image. So it's an art and science that actually empowers an individual to be able to control his visual communication. And sadly, till now, nobody spoke about that. There was so much emphasis on body language. There was so much emphasis on the verbal content or the way we speak. But actually, when people see us for the first time, they form an impression about us within seconds. And what is really, what is the base of this impression or this image that they're forming upon us is what they see, is what I'm wearing, how I'm carrying myself, how I'm standing, all of that put together. So it's an art and science that empowers you in the true sense to control what you communicate visually and to be able to control what other people think about you.
Absolutely.
And ma'am, in the past 10 years, I have seen people, the same people. I live in that same circle, right? In the past 10 years, these same people, the way they treated me has changed. And as a person, I haven't changed. My personality has not changed. The only thing that has changed is the way I present myself to the world, if I may say so. So I have lived it. And from experience, I can say that this has been the most powerful change in my life.
And I can very clearly see that change. I mean, this change is very evident to everyone.
Ma'am, you remember what I wore in my first class? Not even class, when you came
Absolutely.
To meet us for the first time. I have a picture of that. Oh my God. And someday I'll do a before and after series of my own self.
No, I completely understand. And I remember the transition that you have been through, the complete transformation that you have been through. I mean, that's like really, really commendable.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, Dia, I know you since last 10 years now. I mean, it's been a decade.
Yes, ma'am.
So, what is Dia of today in comparison to Dia, which was 10 years ago?
There's a lot of difference. I mean, to start with, I'm far more confident of myself today. When I had started out, it was after a sabbatical. I'd taken a sabbatical from work. It had been 3.5 years that I had not been working.
True.
I had been at home doing absolutely nothing that I felt was productive or substantial, you know. So that level of confidence, I have always been a very confident kid. I mean, even from my childhood, and I've been a very confident individual. But those 3.5, 4 years, I had lost my confidence to achieve as an achiever. The confidence to succeed. That has been the biggest change. Today, I feel confident that I can do anything. I mean, I really feel that if I want to go out and get something done, the level of confidence that I feel within myself has changed. That's one. Two, because of all the soft skills, you know, the polishing that the 10-year program, training in soft skills, training others, there is so much in my soft skills that has changed. The way I deal with people, the way I talk to people, the way I treat people. There is this sensitivity that I think as a corporate adult, you know, I've grown up in the corporate culture. There's that sensitivity that I think I kind of had lost. So there is this vast difference from when I started 10 years back and what I am 10 years today. And I like myself what I am today compared to the one 10 years back.
Absolutely. So I think in last 10 years, I mean, there has been so much of change, such
yes,
huge difference between Diya of, you know, that time vis-a-vis Diya of today. I mean, I can vouch for it for sure.
Thank you, ma'am. In fact, there have been times when you have asked me to do something that I thought I will not be able to do. I mean, taking up certain projects and assignments, when you told me that believe in yourself, go ahead and you will be able to do it. Those were times I used to go to bed worrying that, you know, when somebody has a lot of confidence in you and when somebody confidently tells you that, you know, I know you'll be able to do it, then that burden of, you know, performance and that accountability that you have towards that other individual, I spent sleepless nights. But had I not been pushed, had I not been pushed by Hina, had I not been pushed by you to take up certain assignments, to do certain things, I would have probably never done it. So, and after doing it, the realization that yes, this is something that I can do. I am capable of doing.
I think the best of the outcome that comes out of from an individual is when somebody pushes you.
Yes, ma'am.
That's something yes, which always happens. I mean, you need that kind of a push from someone or the other, and the person who pushes you knows your capability. And that is why that belief is always there.
And that is why you need people like that in your life.
Yeah, that push is for the right reason, for sure.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Absolutely. So I feel honestly very glad.
Absolutely.
Sorry, there's a lag, I think, ma'am. There's a lag. Please, you were saying.
Others. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. I can.
So what according to you, will be the new business trend after this pandemic? I mean, we know that we are going through this pandemic situation and everybody is worried about. So what do you think would be the trend post-pandemic or during pandemic, and how has it impacted your work personally?
Okay, so the first thing I feel in terms of appearance as an image consultant, if I think of how people are going to think of their dressing, sustainability is now going to become very important. Everybody is going to think of saving money. So cost effectivity, being economic, sustainability, when it will come to investment in themselves, in their appearance, that's going to be the key thing. Already I am working with clients where we are not doing anything but just shopping from their own wardrobe. So two women that I'm working with currently, they are working women. Their role has got enhanced, a job has become more important because the platform is virtual, but they don't want to invest money in their clothes at this point of time. So we are actually creating virtually, ma'am. I initially thought that this is going to be absolutely impossible, but we are doing a wardrobe consultation. I'm helping them shop from their own wardrobe. I think that is going to be one of the biggest change for us or any fashion professional, is that sustainability or cost effectivity of people are going to now think of saving money. So our role in the place where we can help them you know, in personal styling, in a manner that they can have less clothes and more outfits, how they can communicate effectively even through a virtual platform, or skill development. So suddenly this, you know, this work training assignments that have come up, everybody has time now, relatively more time than they had in the past. And certain skills that they feel that they need to develop, like communication, like presenting themselves well, soft skills. These are skills that will become more important over a virtual platform, since more and more business networking meetings and everything is happening over a virtual platform. So if you personally ask me work-wise, as a professional, what has changed is now instead of going personal shopping with my clients, we are thinking of ways of how to maximize or take out, you know, stretch the wardrobe as much as they can. So from that perspective, it has changed. I'm still doing body shape evaluation. I'm still doing color, all of that. But from a post-pandemic, people have become extremely cost effective. So everybody's talking of sustainability. Everybody's talking about how do I present myself over a virtual platform. As a trainer, however, corporate assignments have gone up because I feel now suddenly corporates have realized that, you know, organizing trainings over a virtual platform, something like Zoom, is much more easier for them rather than me going or us as trainers going to their centers and doing training work. Because now pan India, they can have all their employees over a period of 3 days. They have 150 or 140 employees sit with us in a training room instead of us doing trainings in 4 or 5 locations, which also was, you know, not as cost effective. So post pandemic, as training work, corporate assignments, as well as individual assignments, the work remains the same. It's just the perspective from the client that has completely changed. So,
but there is more reduction bigger of work organized. Because people have this perception that work has reduced or work will reduce drastically when it comes to, you know, image consulting business.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. In fact, like I said, and I'm being very honest with you, in the past 4 months, I have done more work than I had done in the past 8-9 months. So there were certain corporate organizations where we had trainings planned, you know, for the year. And because of the lockdown, everything got cancelled. And we did one session online and they realized the... So there are pros and cons of everything. The virtual platform, the biggest pros are that people from all over the country. So if an organization has employees pan India, they can get the training done at one time in one location. So it in fact works better for the organization. Then now after doing trainings on Zoom, everybody has kind of enjoyed the luxury or comfort of providing training programs from the comforts of the location where they are. So yeah. Corporate training work in fact has gone up. To be very honest with you, it has actually gone up.
Okay. So Diya, people often follow others for their style. I mean, you deal a lot in personal style and, you know, I mean, people talk about personal styling and, you know, and you specialize in personal style. So what are the 3 most important tips which help people project an authentic image yet appear stylish?
Okay, so one thing is, I think whenever I've worked with so many individuals and the first thing I always realize is, ma'am, that most people don't know what they like and what they don't like. So when they go out shopping, if you evaluate their wardrobe, and whenever we do wardrobe evaluation, 45%, at least 45% of their wardrobe are full of clothes that they either don't like the color or they don't like the fabric. And when I ask them, why did you buy this? They say, I don't know. Maybe it was on sale. Maybe that was a trend at that point of time, but I have not worn it since. So I feel reason number one that people are unable to develop their own personal style is they don't know what they like and what they don't like. So the first most important step is to identify where you come from, to identify what is your comfort zone, and to identify what you love and what you don't love and why. The minute you start answering the whys, so is this a particular color that you don't like? So the first thing is to be able to sit down and identify in clothes, what is it that I love? What is it that I don't love? And what is the reason? And the best way to do it is to pull out 10 favorite garments from their wardrobe and 10 not so favorite garments. And they can evaluate and find out, okay, these are my 10 favorite. What are the reasons why I love these garments? That's reason number one, to be able to identify what they love. Reason number two, tip number two, I feel, is to look at people whom they get attracted to for their sartorial sense. So, for example, somebody might look up to Priyanka Chopra, somebody might look up to Shabana Azmi for the way he or she dresses. To be able to identify people whom we appreciate the way they dress, and then be able to identify what is it about this person that I love the most. And then start working upon, this is what I'm comfortable wearing. This is what I love. How are these two things coming together? So A is to identify what I like, what I don't like, to be able to identify that. B is to look around people and see what inspires or motivates you. And C is to step out of your comfort zone bit by bit. People are so comfortably sitting in what they've been wearing for so many years that they're even hesitant to step out of their comfort zone. So these are the three things that I feel that if one needs to be, one needs to develop a personal style and remain true and authentic to yourself is to first identify what they like, what they don't like. B, look around for motivation, inspiration. And C, over a period of time, wear something in which they feel like themselves. Looking like who I think I am. For example, if I feel that I am a confident individual, when I look at myself in the mirror, is my image saying the same thing to me? I know it's more complicated, you know, when we talk about developing your own personal style, but over a period of time, dressing in a manner in which you feel like yourself, you're comfortable psychologically as well as physically. And gradually, it will move the individual into developing a personal style. So many people, when they come to me for personal styling, I tell them that it's not something that happens overnight. It has to be given time, it has to be given effort and thought. But once you really do develop your true personal style, then the confidence that that individual exudes from his or her appearance is not, you know, is unmatched, I feel.
And I'm sure in personal style, there is nothing like fake it till you make it.
Absolutely, ma'am. Absolutely. Therefore, people need to have to step out of their comfort zone. If you're comfortably sitting and, you know, doing things the way that you've been doing for so long, stepping out of your comfort zone and, yeah, like you said, fake it till you make it. Absolutely.
So there is another question, a common question which we encounter most of the time, that why do people internationally, so one person who's viewing this live session has said, Arunima says that why do people internationally in the tech industry like Mark Zuckerberg don't seem to care so much about their appearance? Their dressing is pretty casual. Your thoughts, please. So, you know, Dia, we do come across this question very often.
I don't think I have ever done a corporate training without one member from the training asking me this question and Mark Zuckerberg's name coming up. So there are two sides to this story. Side number one is that we see the IT industry mostly dressing up casually. So a lot of people say that, have you ever gone to the Google office? And the Google office people are sitting on a sofa in their t-shirt and denims and they're working like that. So the first thing is that these people who are working in the IT industry, especially like Google, their main driving force, their professional expertise, the key word is creativity. The reason Google as a company or a lot of IT companies allow or give this freedom to their employees to dress very casually is for them to feel physically, psychologically comfortable and to allow creativity to flow. However, if we look at Mark Zuckerberg in person, the journey that he has had, I don't know whether the person who's asked this question has seen the movie, which was based on his life. You know, when he was fighting the lawsuits during Facebook time, you will observe that Mark Zuckerberg during those years always dressed very casually. And the time that he spent in that firm fighting for his, you know, for Facebook, there was a lot of heat that he or a lot of hostility that he experienced from everybody because of his body language, which was so much deep-rooted because of the kind of casual attire that he always wore. Had he been more professionally dressed and more seriously dressed, people over there would have taken him more seriously and he would have faced less heat and he would have faced less of hostility during that period. Secondly, somebody like Mark Zuckerberg, when there is a certain amount of success that you achieve, even Steve Jobs, today we see him in t-shirt and denims, but when he was a struggler and he was going from company bank to bank for investment in his company, he had bought a suit. It's written in his autobiography. He was forced to buy a suit, which he used to call a marketing suit, because he realized that the minute he walked into a t-shirt and a denim in a bank for an investment, the bank managers didn't, the bank didn't take him seriously. And if when we talk of Mark Zuckerberg, when he met our prime minister, somebody is always dressed in a t-shirt and a pair of denims. When he met our prime minister, who was the head of state for the biggest market for Facebook, India is the biggest market for Facebook. He didn't come in a t-shirt and a pair of denim. He chose to wear a suit. He dressed very formally. So because the opinion of this man mattered to the achievement of his goals. And therefore, Mark Zuckerberg also for that occasion chose to dress up.
And in a lot of all important occasions, Mark Zuckerberg is always in a suit.
Always dressed in a suit. Yeah, always. Yes. Even for the ceremony for his daughter, they have this ceremony in the church. I don't know what, it's a christening ceremony. Even those, you see pictures on social media, he's not in his t-shirt and denim. It's an important occasion in his life. So he dresses up for those occasions. It's also like, ma'am, when you become successful, you know, you're a trendsetter. If Salman Khan walks into a college without his t-shirt and is topless and is walking, he's Salman Khan. It's a style statement. But imagine some normal student in a college campus walking without a t-shirt. I mean, when you become successful, when you reach a certain stage in life, what you wear, you know, kind of, it's different from people like us. So, but even these people, when they're dressing up for important occasions, they choose to dress up. And now the West, ma'am, is going through another... It's like a reverse change.
Yes.
You see the social media throughout is talking about dressing up for the virtual platform. It's full of articles and it started from the West. It's full of articles talking about why should you wear a shirt for a Zoom meeting. So it's kind of a reverse swing that this pandemic has also now bought back. So even though they are wearing a pair of shorts, which is not visible, on the top half, they're the ones who are talking about dressing up over a virtual medium also.
Absolutely. So, Diya, you have worked with many young children. What are the two most important things of today's, that today's parents should really take care of? And what are the suggestions or what are the recommendations you would give to the parents so that they focus more on the personal development of these children?
Ma'am, two things after working with, I've recently done some work with teenagers also, and I love working with children. So from 7 to 14 years is the age group that I have done maximum work with. In fact, yesterday I was counting the number of kids that I have worked with. I have worked with 5,000 kids, 3,500 plus kids just for dining etiquette, and so many teenagers. In fact, if you remember, there was this beautiful workshop we used to do at ICBI called Future Adult. If you ask me my favorite work that I have done, I've learned two things about the teenager today. Thing number one is they're far more exposed and aware than we were at their age. So treating them like an adult is a great thing to do. Even in my dining etiquette workshop, ma'am, I do everything that I do with adults. It's just done in a more fun manner. But whatever you share with them, they absorb and learn. Their learning curve is so steep. They learn so fast and they learn so well. So the teenager today wants to be treated like an adult. You treat that child not like a child and like an adult, he or she is more likely to listen to you. That's one of my key learnings. And second key learning is instead of telling them to do something, if you give them the rationale or the logic, if you speak to them with logic, that's when they are sold. That is when they will buy your idea. So recently a friend of mine had invited me to her house for tea because her daughter used to wear very short shorts and go to her tuition class. And she said that she doesn't listen to me. I've been telling her, but maybe you're an image consultant. She has that image of you. If you tell her, she'll listen to you. And over a candid talk, ma'am, I never told her that you should not wear shorts. We sat there and we spoke about communication of clothes. I started talking about, you know, where skin shows, attention goes. What does a very short garment like this communicate and that particular occasion? What is appropriate attire for appropriate occasions? We discussed this. She was wearing her pair of shorts leaving for her tuition. How attention goes to certain parts of your body, which may, you know, you may or may not attract unnecessary attention. My objective was to sell logic. She didn't say yes or no to me at that point of time, but her mother shared with me later, after that discussion, she never wore her shorts to her tuition class. So A, when you treat them like an adult, and B, when you sell them logic, not reprimand them or tell them ki ye karna hai aur ye nahi karna hai. The minute you start telling them that this is what you're supposed to do, it's like a rebound action. They start rebelling back. So if you give them logic that this is the reason why you should wear it, and this is the reason why you should not wear this on this occasion, and then they immediately buy the logic. They listen.
Yeah, completely agree with you, because I also have two children, and emotions really don't work most of the time, but logic definitely works.
Because absolutely,
they understand logic, and at the same time, they are more aware of what is happening because they are mostly on the computer.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
They are always
yes, ma'am.
Reading, always, you know, up to something or the other. I mean, most of the time, contrary to popular belief that they are almost on Netflix most of the time, but they also improve their general knowledge, you know, when they are sitting on the computer, because they want to know what is happening in the world. So they are very well aware. They have that curiosity built in, so that they are, you know, completely in sync with what is happening in today's times. So in terms
yes, ma'am.
Of their general knowledge, I mean, as compared to us, I mean, their general knowledge is far more superior than anybody else.
Yes, ma'am. During our times, we used to depend upon our parents. So if a child's parents were very well-read, well-exposed, and they would pass it on to the child, you would see the difference in that child. But it's not the case anymore. Now every child has access to Google. If they are looking for an answer, they will go straight to Google and get that answer. So their level of awareness is so high. And in those times, when I'm doing workshops with teenagers, ma'am, they sit with their phones. And if I'm sharing some information with them, they Google it to recheck. So if I take up the role of somebody who's telling them that you eat with a fork and knife because I'm telling you to eat with a fork and knife, they are never going to do it. And they're going to question me that you are saying this, but Google is saying that. So you are now, I'm with teenagers, in fact, you are more of a facilitator. You're talking about knowledge that they already know, but you're selling them logic why they should be following this in their daily lives.
Absolutely.
And once you're able to convince them with logic, they just follow you. They are a wonderful group to work with them.
Very true. So Diya, you have been an experienced image consultant, and you have been practicing in this image consulting field from last so many years. How important is image consulting skill for people to climb the ladder of success? And what makes you believe this thought?
What makes me? I'm sorry, I didn't get the last
what
bit, ma'am.
What makes you believe this thought that it is image consulting is a very important skill for people to climb the ladder of success?
Absolutely, ma'am. Because I feel it is if one of the three things that one an individual needs to succeed, apart from core knowledge and hard work, is how he or she presents himself to the world. 98%, I would say 99% of people who approach us, who approach an image consultant, is not because they want to look good, ma'am. It is because they have got stuck somewhere in their life. And it's not people who only come to us for professional work. It's not only professionals who are not either getting a job or a promotion or are not being taken seriously, or opportunities that they deserve are not coming to them but going to somebody else. These are a few reasons why professionals are coming to image consultants. So at every stage in their professional career, they're getting stuck and they're looking for somebody who can help them present themselves better and then pushing forward. It's not only them. We have homemakers who are coming to us, who are feeling this sense of low self-esteem. Image consulting, I feel, is something that is directly related to the two root, you know, the two root reasons for our life: happiness and peace of mind. I mean, how you look affects how people treat you. And if people don't treat you well, it affects how happy you are. It affects your peace of mind. I mean, I feel, what is the purpose of life? These are the two purposes of life: to remain happy and to remain peaceful, right? Image consulting in a manner helps people achieve these two important things. Homemakers are coming to us because they are a part of a social group where they are not being accepted. And it is this, even though this woman is well settled, has a good family and everything is there, but because of that lack of social acceptance, is not happy and is suffering mental health issues. So image consulting, I feel, is not only very essential for success in your professional life, but in your personal as well as social life, it plays an equally important role, ma'am. For example, somebody who's a very successful businessman, I have so many clients when they've become the chairman and presidents for groups like, let's say, Rotary or let's say Roundtable, suddenly they've taken upon a role and they feel that they're not being taken seriously enough. So if you ask me, image consulting as a skill for an individual should be something that should be now be introduced even in schools, so that people grow up learning the fact that how you present yourself impacts your work, your relationships, your happiness, your peace of mind. So it is far more than how you present yourself. It is a skill that can help you remain happy, that can help you achieve mental peace, you know, peace of mind. I don't know if I'm able to express myself completely, but I feel it's a skill which is far deep rooted rather than just appearance, that most people think that what is it? It's all about appearance, right? But it's affecting your relationship building. It is affecting how happy you are. It is affecting your mental health. So it is a very important skill, man. And at all three sections in your life, in your personal life, in your social life, in your professional life.
Very true. Absolutely. So, Diya, I clearly remember when I had started coming to Vadodara when, you people were getting trained and I was personally training all of you. You were going through a lot of low phase in your life at that point of time.
Yes, ma'am.
So, yes, how ma'am. Did you overcome that phase and how did you accept that challenge and come out as a winner during that time?
Ma'am, actually, at that time, it was a personal loss that I had faced, and though you're aware of it, I had my miscarriage at that point of time, and 3 years of no work, sitting at home, and I would often think that, you know, that sense of feeling lost, and that's when I came across the ad for the institute. I attended the seminar, and I also thought that, you know, when I'll go to the classroom and study, it'll be something that'll help me remain occupied. But as I started, you know, as the program started, I started going deeper and deeper and deeper in it. Not only did it take my mind off it, that was just one part of it. The other very powerful part of about it was that this program will empower me. So the confidence that I started developing, I looked different. I felt different. I was occupied into doing something that kept my mind off, and the realization of the fact that how many people that, you know, you can impact. So I think it took me 2 years. One was the community that I built up while I was studying. There were so many people who were, you know, in that same life phase where they had taken a sabbatical, but the program gave me something to start working upon. It gave me hope to move forward. And If I can very confidently say that that phase when I did that program, ma'am, initially 6 months when I started, I had never thought I would come this far. But the way the program was designed and the way it kind of just aligned the freelance, the working, the flexibility of the working hours, how it aligned into my life, it just helped me come out of it. And today, honestly, when I even think about it, there's no bitterness. There is this sense of, I am so glad that at that point of time, what took me towards the program, maybe it was destiny that I was destined to follow this path, but what took me towards doing the program was I took it up as something that this will keep my mind off. How I got engrossed in the program, how it became like a hope to follow, and how it took me towards a path where, you know, I started enjoying my work, and that passion, it just helped me move forward, ma'am. And I'm so grateful. I think that was one of the best decisions I took independently for myself. Otherwise, what happens, you know, most decisions, there's somebody or the other always influencing you in in your life, whether you want to do a postgrad program, whether you want to do something with your life, there is some of the, this was one decision that I independently took for myself. And so far, the best decision that I have taken.
Brilliant. So I also have two more questions, but I think we are running out of time. So I'll ask you one last question, Diya. One message for all those people who have keen interest in pursuing image consulting as their profession.
So my message would be, the time is now. This is the time to get into this. It's A, the biggest and most lucrative professions of the new century. B, overthinking always, like our soft skill classes, don't overthink. This is the right time to jump into it. It's going to be the biggest, it's like the biggest career coming up in the future. And if you're somebody who's either looking for flexible working hours, who is passionate to work with people, who is passionate to make a difference in the life of another individual, or is passionate about fashion, this is the right profession to be in. I think my message is, the time is now, ma'am. Right now is the time to jump into this profession and get the certification done.
I think, dear, I mean, in your situation, everything was so different. I mean, I would not say adverse, but I would say different, because you came from a place where people never believed that image consulting will work. Secondly, you took a break.
Yes,
your
ma'am.
Sabbatical was for almost 3 to 4 years.
Yes,
you had your own personal challenges when it came to style. I mean, you overcame all those things and you turned out to be such a winner. And today everybody has become your fan. I mean, the only thing that has really worked for you is your passion, your determination, and your dedication. I think these three things have really worked very well for you, because you have...
Ma'am, one more...
...to the content. Yes.
One more thing. It's also the support. So, I'll be very honest here. I'm not saying this because I'm speaking to you. But the support has been one more pillar. Hard work and passion, I would say, are two things that from my end worked. But the support from the institute is the third pillar. That, you know, there were times when I thought that, no, this is, you know, when you keep telling yourself that you can't do this, you will not be able to do this. You keep saying that yourself to your, you have those low phases. In the first 5 years, those dips were there. But there was immense support. I remember the first time I got an assignment from the CA Institute, I didn't write to anybody else. I wrote to Sir directly. I wrote to Mr. Agarwal. I don't know even if you're aware of that. He connected me to three image consultants who had CA background. And when I did my first corporate assignment, and there was this big curriculum, there was this big thing that they wanted to tell me, humne tab soft skills nahi kiya tha. We had not done soft skills training. And a big part of that corporate assignment was soft skills training. I received a lot of business support. Not many institutes, which kind of institute when you pass out will provide you support when you get stuck in a particular project. That has also been one of the key reasons why so many people who themselves were very willing to work, who showed that, you know, that energy to work, and they received a lot of support. So if you honestly ask me, the one thing that kept me afloat during my very bad time was support from the institute. From Baroda, from our Vadodara center, through Hina, as well as from the head office. Whether it was for content, even motivational talk. You know, when somebody, I don't know if you remember, over the phone you once told me that if you will think, you will keep overthinking and your insecurity will never let you work. Stop thinking about it, do your best, prepare your best, and just go and do the training. That was my first corporate assignment, ma'am. So this was when I had received a lot of help for content. So I think what has kept me afloat is also the support that initially I got. I still have that support. I know that, ma'am. But initially, it was so important, and that has been one of the reasons that kept me afloat during the first 5 years. And I'm very grateful for it. I have many times told you that, but I want to take this opportunity again to say that one of the reasons that a lot of us have remained, you know, steady in our work is because of the kind of support we have received. And thank you so much for it. Thank you.
Yours. Absolutely welcome, and thank you for making us proud, because you are one person who's like a backbone of ICPI. So just
thank you, ma'am.
That.
Thank you so much.
and all the very best, Dia.
Thank you so much for
being a part of this live session, and I'm sure a lot of value addition has happened and a lot of people have got a lot of insights from your conversation with them. So keep rocking the way you are rocking right now, and all the very best from our side. And for all the people who are watching this live session, we'll be back with another very special guest next week. So stay tuned and we'll be back soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.